Take you out. Good morning, good morning. Morning, morning. Hope you're well. It's good to see you all. I was hoping that all of you guys would be here and you're all here, so that's exactly what I wanted. Perfect. It's great to see you. My name's Jonah, if I've not met you before. I'm one of the youth workers here at Woven, which is really fun. I love my job. But it's great to have you back. Anyone excited for school tomorrow? Yeah, Miles is excited. I'm glad some people. Tom, you're going back to school. Always learning, that's what I love to see. Right, it's great to have you. Well, welcome to St. Margaret's. If you've never been before, it's great to have you. If you've been before, it's great to have you back. If you're watching online, it's lovely to see you. Hope you get some comments in or do whatever you need to do. We'd love to hear from you. But I don't think we're not going to hang around. We're going to get into some, what are we doing first? Action worship? Oh, prayer. I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray us into action worship. So if you're a young person or you love actions, then please come down to the front because I am not going to do that. Not because I just can't multitask. I'm really bad. I've been practicing, but I'll do it from the side. So Lord, we just thank you so much that you're here with us this morning. We invite you here. We invite your spirit here with us. Help us to have fun, to engage with you, to encounter you, to learn a little bit more about you. And Lord, we pray we can help do that through some worship. This morning with you now. In your name we pray. Amen. Please stand if you will.
To your words, I know you will like mine.
job, guys. You guys can take a seat now. Thank you so much. We're just going to continue our worship this morning, and part of our worship, we believe, is through financial giving. So if you're able and you're willing, we're going to have the offering come round now during this song. But it's also just a time to keep worshiping if you want as well. Lord, we just thank you for this moment of encounter with you, Lord. We thank you that your spirit is here, that you are with us, Lord. We thank you for the offering and the money that's been given this morning, Lord. We pray you bless that. We pray you'd use that for your will. Lord, guide us as we work out what to do with that money, Lord Jesus. We pray you continue meeting with us this morning. Amen. Come on, please take a seat. Kids are going out. So if you're in year five and below, now's your time to shine. We've got exciting stuff. We've got year sixes moving up to youth this morning. So if you're in year six, stay for a little bit longer. We'll be going out in a minute. But yeah, year fives and below, we'll see you later. I'm just going to pray for you guys. Maybe you want to stretch out a hand. Yeah, Lord, we just pray you bless these guys as they go and learn this morning. go and encounter with you, go learn more about you, and continue their journey with you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay. Seems like it's going well. Okay, we're going to continue worshiping. So if you want to get to your feet again, we're going to lean into Jesus this morning. Lord, we just pray you continue to meet with us, Lord. We want to encounter you. We want to meet with you, Lord. And we want to do that now through sung worship, through spending time with you, Lord. And maybe you want to just spend this time this morning during worship, just thinking about your week, what you're thankful for. Maybe your frustrations, your laments, you might want to just share with God. Take them to him. He wants to hear what you have to say. He says, cast all your anxiety on him. And maybe that's for you this morning. This is a moment just to lean into God, to speak with him, to hear his voice. In your name we pray. Amen.
We welcome you with praise, Almighty God of love. song is forever yours, a thousand. Thank you. Jesus, you blow heaven down. Oh, my sin was great, your love was greater. What can separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name. Name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus.
What a wonderful name it is.
The name of Jesus.
And death cannot hold you.
The veil's torn. Heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names.
What a powerful name
it is, what a powerful name it is.
The
name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence.
I'll speak Jesus. And I just want. Speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break. Declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
See, your name is power. Your name is
power.
I know there is peace within.
And Jesus, we speak that your name. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. And as we were singing the words of those songs, that song that's a prayer, that is a prayer and a song of intercession for our world, for our communities, for our lives. And we now have an opportunity as we gather in worship this morning to pray and to intercede as God's family, as God's church. And I don't know about you, but having looked at the news this weekend and all that is going on in our world, we need to be crying out, we need to be interceding, we need to be speaking the power, the name of Jesus over our world and over different situations. So just as the band now play in the background, I want to encourage us, and if you feel comfortable and able, can I encourage you to stand? There's something quite powerful that when we pray and when we intercede, that actually we're doing spiritual warfare. When we pray, things change, that there is transformation, that God's power and his kingdom comes. So let's, as one voice and as one church, the way we're going to do our prayers and our intercessions this morning is, let's cry out together as one church, in one voice, for perhaps the particular situation in this world that God has put on your heart. Perhaps it's something you saw in the news, what happened in Australia yesterday with the stabbings, or the situation now between Iran and Israel, the ongoing war between Israel and Palestine, Ukraine and Russia. There is so much devastation. There is so much conflict. There is so much darkness, and so much by our human eyes seems impossible. But with God, we know nothing is impossible. All things are impossible. So I'm just going to count us in, and then as one voice, as one church, let's pray, let's cry out to God, let's intercede, let's speak the name of Jesus over situations in our world and in our own community. So after three, one, two, three, Father God, we cry out to you for our world. Lord, we speak your name. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. We pray, Father God, would your kingdom come? Would your will be done in situations in our world that just seem so impossible? Where there's just so much devastation in us. We pray for Australia at this moment. We pray for all those impacted by the stabbing. We pray, Lord, would you bring your comfort? Would you bring your healing and your peace? Would you do what only you can do in these situations? We pray for those who've been injured, Lord, that you would be healing them. Lord, we pray for those who've lost loved ones, that you would come in Jesus. We pray calm and happy prayers. Bring your peace where there is hurt, Lord Jesus. And we pray for the situation between Israel and Palestine. Lord, we don't know what to pray, but we pray your will be done. Father God, we thank you that you are King of Kings and that you are Lord of Lords. And we pray for each and every situation we've lifted to you in prayer. We pray for our broken and hurting world. Lord, we pray your kingdom come and your will be done. Where there is war and there is violence, bring your peace. Where there is injustice, bring your justice. Where your love and your mercy is needed, would it come in greater measure? And we pray for our church around the world, especially in situations of conflict or persecution, Lord. We pray, strengthen our brothers and sisters. Help them to be a beacon of your hope and your life and your truth in the most difficult situations, Lord Jesus. Fill them with your power. And Lord, would you stir in us a heart for prayer and intercession? Would you be calling us onto our knees to pray and to cry out for your world that you so desperately love, that you gave your life? And we thank you, Lord, for the resurrection hope that we have in you. And Lord, remind us again of that hope that we have in you, that there is no situation beyond your resurrection hope. And we pray that for our world, but we also pray that for the different situations in our lives and our community, Lord. Lord, we pray your kingdom come and your will be done. And Lord, here in this moment of prayer, we also bring ourselves before you. And Lord, we're only too conscious where we can often get it wrong and not live our lives with you as King and Lord over them. And perhaps now in the quiet, as the band continue to play, there might be something you just want to bring before God that you want to say sorry to him for, or to allow him to come now by his Spirit and to examine each of our hearts, remembering that he calls us and he loves us just as we are, to bring our whole selves before him. And we have an opportunity in this time of confession to come and say sorry. But in this moment of when we say sorry, to receive his forgiveness, to receive his grace and his love. And a prayer is going to come up on the screen now that we're praying together, which is a prayer to help us in that, in confessing and saying sorry to God. So we pray together, Father eternal, giver of light and grace, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor in what we have thought, in what we have said and done, through ignorance, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We have wounded your love and marred your image in us. We are sorry and ashamed and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and lead us out from darkness to walk as children of light. Amen. And Father God, we thank you, Lord, that you promised in Scripture that when we come to you and bring ourselves before you and confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins, and you cleanse us from everything in our past. So here this morning, in this moment now, we receive your forgiveness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, as ever, we have a smooth transition from prayer and intercession to notices. I'm going to invite Jonah up. In a minute, the young people are going to go out to their group. But before that, Jonah's got a really exciting notice.
Yes, there might be a slide, actually, for this, Finn. There we go. Look at that. Lovely. So this Thursday, we're going to be starting a new thing called Connect United, which is basically a midweek kind of gathering for young people. So if you're year 7 to year 13, we'd love to see you there. It's here Thursday night, 6:30 till 8. But it's basically a place for us to help young people encounter God, but also a place for them to kind of lean into maybe leadership. And like Ryan's going to be leading worship, which is going to be cool. And then we're going to have some other people leading the service and things like that. So it's going to be a really cool opportunity, but it's gathering all the young people from across Woven. So all 8 churches within Woven are going to come together. We're going to connect and we're going to be united, but it's also open to the deanery, which is exciting as well. So we play our part in maybe serving those people and people from around, not even just Church of England churches in the deanery, but also anyone, any young person that's in the deanery. It's more than welcome to come to that. So we're really excited about that. That's this Thursday. So let people know if you want. And if you want to come and help out and be on team, we'd love to have you guys come and be with us. I think it's going to be really fun. And it's hopefully going to see lots of people. But yeah, if you're a young person in here still and you want to come out now, we're going to go. So there you go.
Amazing. Thank you, Jonah. And let's be praying for our young people and for our youth team ahead of Connect United. That's really, really exciting. Just another couple of notices for you, just to say we will have a new term card, hopefully next week, which will have all the key dates for your diary for this term. But I think we've got a video to show, a really exciting video that tells us a little bit more about our Woven Together Day, which is an opportunity for us to gather together as all our Woven churches for a prayer, for worship, for fellowship and community and for fun. And it's going to play now. Wonderful. So it's going to be a great day together. So Saturday, the 22nd of June, put that date in your diary. And it would be amazing if you are like, yes, I'm definitely going to come along. You can scan that QR code to book your place. It would be really helpful for us to know numbers as far enough in advance as possible. So you can book your space there. If you want to know any more, or if the QR code doesn't work and you want to book on a bit more traditionally, then come and speak to me and we can give you more information about that. There is a £15 ticket price for the day, but we don't want money to be a reason why anyone wouldn't come. So that's almost like our suggested amount for the day. But as you book on, you can choose the amount you feel you can afford to pay for the day. So if £15 would be too much, and that's just for adults as well, children are free. But if you book on, there's more information about that there. So we are super excited for Woven Together. So get the date in your diary. Also to let you know, I don't know if we've got a slide for this, but Alpha, we're running another Alpha course, which we're really excited about. We love running Alpha here at St. Margaret's. It's an opportunity to find out more about the Christian faith and to explore different topics of the Christian faith. This term we're going to be running it on a Tuesday night. It's normally on a Wednesday, but we're going to be running it on Tuesday evenings from the 7th of May at 7:30. And you might be thinking you yourself would love to come and do Alpha, or perhaps you know someone you'd like to invite. We'd encourage you to be praying about people you might want to invite to Alpha. If you'd like to know more, come and speak to me. You can sign up for it by scanning that QR code as well. We're very fancy now with our QR codes. Or you can speak to me or email me if you want to know more about that. And my final notice is another date for your diary, which is that our APCM, which is like our annual church meeting where we get together and we can look back and celebrate all that God's been doing in the life of the church over the past year. That is on Sunday the 19th of May. It will be straight after the service. So we're going to have a slightly shorter service. We're then going to have our APCM meeting, and then it's Pentecost, so we're going to have our annual Pentecost picnic as well that day. So that's going to be a jam-packed, fun-filled Sunday morning on the 19th of May. So please do put that date in your diary. That is the end of the notices. In a moment, we're going to have our talk. And we have Rich speaking to us this morning. And you might think, well, how's that going to happen? Because he's not here. It's a little bit different this morning. Rich has pre-recorded our talk for us this morning. We're starting a brand new series exploring the book of Daniel. So Rich is going to be kicking that off. But I'm going to invite Shona up, who's going to bring our Bible reading. And as she comes up, I'm just going to pray for us. So, Father God, we thank you for the gift of your word. We thank you that it's for its power and its truth. And we pray, Holy Spirit, would you come now by your spirit? And as we come to look at your word, would you speak to us through the power of your spirit and be changing and transforming our hearts and minds, we pray. Amen.
So we're starting off with Daniel chapter 1. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord delivered Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, along with some of the articles from the temple of God. These he carried off to the temple of his God in Babylonia and put the treasure house of his God. Then the king ordered Ashpenaz, chief of his court officials, to bring in some of the Israelites from the royal family and the nobility, young men without any physical defect, handsome, showing aptitude for every kind of learning, well-informed, quick to understand, and qualified to serve in the king's palace. He was to teach them the language and literature of the Babylonians. The king assigned them a daily amount of food and wine from the king's table. They were to be trained for 3 years, and after that they were to enter the king's service. Among these were some from Judah: Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. The chief official gave them new names: to Daniel the name Belteshazzar, to Hananiah Shadrach, to Mishael Meshach, and to Azariah Abednego. But Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine, and he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself in this way. Now God had caused the officials to show favor and sympathy to Daniel, but the official told Daniel, "I am afraid of my lord the king, who has assigned your food and drink. Why should he see you looking worse than the other young men of your age? The king would then have my head because of you." Daniel then said to the guard whom the chief official had appointed over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, please test your servant for 10 days. Give us nothing but vegetables to eat and water to drink. Then compare our appearance with that of the young men who eat the royal food, and treat your servants in accordance with what you see. So he agreed to this and tested them for 10 days. At the end of the 10 days, they looked healthier and better nourished than any of the young men who ate the royal food. So the guard took away their choice of food and the wine they were to drink and gave them vegetables instead. To these four young men, God gave knowledge and understanding of all kinds of literature and learning, and Daniel could understand visions and dreams of all kinds. At the end of the time set by the king to bring them in, the chief official presented them to Nebuchadnezzar. The king talked with them, and he found none equal to Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. So they entered the king's service. In every matter of wisdom and understanding about which the kings questioned them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and enchanters in his whole kingdom. And Daniel remained there until the first year of King Cyrus.
Good morning. It's fantastic to see you this morning. For anyone who doesn't know me, my name is Rich, and I lead Woven, which is my privilege and my joy. I'm at Woven St. John's this morning, but also it's a joy to be with you using technology. So hello, welcome. Good to see you all. I don't know if you've ever tried to fit in. You know, I know I have in so many different bits of my life. You know, even now, if I go to a garage and go and see the mechanic, I know absolutely nothing about cars. But I'll start talking about things about the car. And I'll find myself nodding my head saying, oh, yeah, that does look like it's the problem. Inside, I have no idea what on earth is going on. But it's almost like I've been transported back to when I was a kid at school and I couldn't quite get my hair to do the right thing. And my mum bought me the knockoff trainers from the supermarket rather than the branded ones that help me fit in. You know, often in our lives, we can spend all our time trying so hard to fit in. And this morning, we're starting a new Bible series where we're looking at the character of Daniel. The book of Daniel, and we're going to look at some of the other characters, his friends in that, some of the other bits of story in the book of Daniel. And in many ways, we see Daniel as this young man where there's pressure to fit in. But let's back up just a little bit and look at a brief bit of history that just leads us to this point of the book of Daniel. So just before the book of Daniel, have prophets like Isaiah, and they're kind of doom-mongering. They're saying, you know, if you don't repent, don't turn and change your ways, if you don't change being back to be wholehearted to God and caring for the poor, and having right relationships, particularly to the poor and to the needy, then actually, you know, disaster is going to come. Sure enough, they don't pay attention. The Israelites, God's people, and the Babylonians, the great empire of the day, the Babylonians sweep in and bring destruction upon God's people. The city's destroyed, the temple is destroyed. Now, it's so hard for us to get our mindset in this. We kind of read this stuff and go, oh, yeah, the city was destroyed, the temple was destroyed. But actually, you know, when you think about the temple being destroyed, the city was like their land. That was God's possession given to them. And then the temple being destroyed, obviously, the temple was like the place where God touched earth, where the heaven touched earth was the temple. And so that was destroyed. It was like the very heartbeat of what it meant to be a Jew was put under threat by the Babylonians as they swept in and destroyed. Now, many of you will know, then part of the story is that the Babylonians then took off back into their land. They captured particularly really good looking, really gifted, the kind of the best of the best. They'd capture them and they took them back to their land to be kind of taught the way of the Babylonians. And that is the category of Daniel and his friends. They are these young guys who have been caught by this invading, conquering, powerful, mighty army. Their whole way of life has been kind of destroyed, pushed down. And then they, as a smallish group, have been selected and drawn out as key leaders and taken off for this kind of a program of helping them become Babylonians. We're going to get back into what that means in a little bit. But just place yourself again into the shoes of the people of God. You know, they were left asking themselves the question, where on earth is God in all of this? You know, in their reality of life, where that was the key question of the age. Where the heck is God? And in many ways, the answers often change between different people. Some decided God's just not in control, guys. You know, some of the people in that day, that was their kind of understanding of what had happened. God's not in control. Others concluded that God had just simply given up on them. God, you look at what's happened. They said, God has given up on us. And a very small minority said, maybe God's not finished with us yet. And, you know, before we get into anything else on this passage, I just wanted to say this for us. There is such a temptation in our age to make that same thought. Maybe God's just not in control. Maybe even you've thought that. Maybe God's just not in control. Or maybe we just think, you know, actually, maybe God's just not got good for me. Maybe God's just given up on me. Maybe even you feel like that this morning. Well, actually, the invitation through the book of Daniel is to join the minority that say, you know what, maybe God's not quite done yet. Maybe this just isn't quite the end of the story. And actually, what we can see through the book of Daniel is a bunch of people who try and work out what on earth does it mean for us to live in this moment where it feels like things are out of control. But the story's not done yet. We're living in the reality that we're saying the story's not done yet. But then what do we do now? How do we live now? What does this mean for us now? Now, there is no better picture for us as Christians today, is there? You know, I know we've said it so often. It just feels like so many things feel out of control, and where's our culture going, and what's happening all around us, and is this even good, and where's God? Where are you? Well, as we live in that moment ourselves, not quite knowing what God's going to do at the end of the story, having a good sense he's not finished yet, living in the reality of the mess of today, how do we live? What do we do? What decisions do we make? And so we're going to journey with Daniel and his pals as they work that out. So back to Daniel, back to, you know, knowing, just think about this for a minute. Daniel and his friends, they knew that they were the best of the best of the best because they were picked, right? I mean, this is a good thing that they've been picked. You know, this is a great thing for their prospects. You know, you think about it, you've just been invaded by this powerful, mighty force, and then they pick you as the few really exceptional ones they're going to take off to try and help them be like the Babylonians, try and learn the culture, try and kind of engage with their ways. I mean, in many ways, there's a great temptation here, isn't there, for Daniel and his friends? Oh, my goodness, there's a great temptation. If they just do this really well, if they just live this out really, really well, imagine how far they could go. Because you see, the aim here is complete assimilation of God's people. The Babylonians were incredibly smart people. They were really smart empire builders. You know, one of the reasons they managed to build such a massive empire all around them, the way they managed to take over so many different lands and hold it all together as this giant Babylonian expanding empire, was that actually they didn't just use force. You see, what the Babylonians did is they'd use force first. They'd go and take over and conquer. Of course, they had to do that in order to do the next phase. So they'd go and conquer, take over. But then their next step was actually genius. Their next step was to try and assimilate the people. And the way they did that was they'd draw out these key leaders, bright, good-looking, brilliant, clear, young, the ones that they could form, the up-and-coming ones. They'd bring them into their place and try and create them as their kind of model citizens to show the rest of the people, look, this is how you live now. This is what it means for your people to live under our people as part of this great big thing. And it was incredibly effective. And that is what they're trying to do here. I mean, look at what happens to Daniel. Daniel's name is changed. Daniel's location is changed. They placed him away from everything he knows. Many of the things that he would have cherished have been destroyed. He's placed in a space where the spiritual practices are nothing to do with his spirituality. His food was going to be totally different to what he's used to. Now, there are all the different things going on for Daniel. And you can kind of imagine Daniel saying, well, what do I do? Here was Daniel as this Jewish man with a Jewish identity, an identity built around being a child of God, a follower of God, the one true God. That was his identity. But then attached onto that and attacking that sense of identity was changing his name. So no longer did Daniel have a Jewish name. He had a Babylonian name. But then Daniel and his friends, into this moment, they decide the one thing they're going to make a stand about is not eating the food. Now, if you're anything like me, you kind of look at this and think, why the food? You know, why didn't they just say, I'm not answering to that new name? Because in some ways, a name is such an incredibly defining thing of who we are, isn't it? Maybe they should have made a stand on that. So why do they make a stand about what food they eat? It seems strange to us. If I'm honest, I've heard all sorts of commentators who tie themselves in knots and people thinking about this going, well, maybe it's because the food's so particular and because it's sacrificed to other gods, and etc. And all of that, I'm sure, is true. But here's the thing. My reading of this, as I read this text, my sense of it is simply of Daniel and his friends looking for one thing, one stake in the ground that they can make, one way in which they can hold on to their real, true identity and not let it go. It's almost like they just needed something. They needed to put down an anchor. They needed to put down a marker. They needed to make a stand in one way that meant that they could cope with the assault that was happening to their identity. And so they chose the food. And I wonder if they chose the food because it was the one thing, as they looked at us, they thought, we actually possibly, maybe, might just get away with making this stand. Maybe it was just as much as their faith would take them to make this one stand. The little bit that was left in them, maybe this was all they had to go, you know what, we can't face the name thing, we can't face the other things, but you know what? We're going to make a stand on the food. We've got faith to make the stand on the food. This key leader, Daniel, decides to make a stand. He decided to be prepared to be different. You know, immediately, as soon as Daniel and his friends do it, they're marked out as different. They're not fitting in. And you know, this is a really risky strategy, isn't it? Really risky. I mean, just really risky in the basics of not eating the choice food when they're trying to become the best of the best of the best. I mean, they're literally putting their lives at risk. But in some ways, even more than that. Because they're making a stand in saying, you know what, we're not going to be fully assimilated. We're not going to do it. We are going to cling on to our identity as God's people, and we're not going to let it go. He's prepared to be different. He's prepared to look a fool. He's prepared to take a chance. He was prepared to make a stand. But friends, here's the thing. Me and you are also called to make a stand. You today are called to make a stand. You know, this is exactly what Peter's getting at in 1 Peter 2:11. Dear friends, he says, I urge you as foreigners and exiles, just like Daniel. Daniel is a foreigner and an exile. He's not in his land. He's not in the place that he would long to be. Friends, you're not in the fullness of God's kingdom yet, are you? We're not in heaven. We're not in the new earth and new heavens that God wants to create. We're not in the fullness of God's kingdom. We're not seeing it yet. We are also foreigners and exiles. So what does Peter say? Dear friends, I urge you as foreigners and exiles to abstain from sinful desires which wage war against your soul. You know what this passage in 1 Peter 2 is getting at is this. Just like Daniel, your identity as a child of God, as a Christian, as a follower of Jesus, as a person who is trying to live out what it means to seek God's kingdom before anything else, all of those pieces of your identity are under constant assault because right now you're living as a foreigner and exile, just like Daniel. Everything is going to try and assimilate you into the way of this world. Everything is going to try and assimilate you into the way of this world. Just like the Babylonians were trying to build an empire, our enemy, the devil, is trying to build an empire. And let's face it, it's a lot easier for him to just try and gently assimilate all the Christians to be a little bit more like the world that he's trying to make than it is to actually try and burn the church down. And so what does the enemy try and do? Just tries to make the Christians a little bit more like the world that he's trying to build. Just a little bit more lying to get ahead. Just a little bit more cheating or stealing. Just a little bit more gossip. Just a little bit of refusing to forgive one another. Just a little bit of not pressing into God. Just a little bit of trying to go our own way and not letting God be in control. Just a little bit more just hanging out and watching telly instead of meeting with Jesus. Just a bit. Just bit by bit by bit. By bit, we have an enemy who's trying to build a kingdom by assimilating us. Just like Daniel's identity was under pressure, yours is too. Mine is too. And before we know it, if we're not careful, we can say, I'm a Christian. But no one would know it because we're no different. No one would know it because we're no different. Just like Daniel. Daniel could have got to the point where he would say, but I'm a Jew. And everyone would say, sure, that's fine. You feel free. You're no different from the rest of us. That was exactly what the Babylonians were after. That's exactly what our enemy is after. He wants to silence God's kingdom makers, kingdom builders upon this earth by assimilating us. It's his first tactic. So friends, what do we do? Because in some ways, all of us have elements which we're probably thinking, oh my goodness, how much do I stand out as a follower of Jesus on this day? What on earth do I do about it? You see, I think it's in making little stands every single day. I remember a few years ago, a lot of years ago, actually, when I was finishing university, I had a short break before I was working out what was next. So I got a job, and I got a job on a building site. And I remember filling out the application form for this job, but all I was doing was laboring. I had absolutely no skill at all, so I was just going to lug concrete around for a few weeks to try and earn some money before I stepped into my next thing. And I was filling out this form, and under on the form, which was the application form, had all sorts of stuff, you know, what kind of skills did you have? And I was like, pretty much none. And, you know, all this kind of stuff. And then further down the form, it said, you know, what are your key interests? And as I was writing this form, the first thing that jumped into my brain was Jesus. What's my key interest? Jesus. And then I was like, well, I can't write that. Oh, my goodness. I mean, I can't write my key interest is Jesus. You know, I started to write other stuff like Arsenal and coffee or whatever. And then I had this prickle in the back of my spine, you know, my hair stood up. And I had this, like, conviction. What I felt like God was saying, no, you now need to put it. And so I really wrestled with it. I remember thinking, I'm a Jesus fan or something strange like that. I know what I'll do. I'll write that I'm a Christian. And I wrote it really small, you know, like, I'm a Christian. Okay, fine, I've ticked the box. I've done what God told me to. But it was like this teeny, teeny, teeny little way of not just ignoring that conviction, but making a tiny, tiny stand. And I handed my application form in, and they gave me the job, and I started work on this building site, and I was working away in the building site, and then the foreman came in. The guy who was in charge of the building site came in, marched into the room in front of all these other people, and he said, "Oi, you!" I was up on the scaffolding at the time. He said, "Oi, you!" And I was like, yeah, okay, hi. He said, "Are you a Christian?" And I was like, yes, I'm a Christian. And then he shouted out in front of everyone, all these other guys, "I wouldn't have hired you if I'd known," and he stormed off. And I was like, oh my goodness, why did I write that on my form? What was I thinking? Why did I write that on my form? But you know what? The most amazing thing happened all that summer as I worked on this building site, because the first week was all just everyone taking the mickey out of me for being a Christian. You know, some of them found out I wasn't married, and so I was a virgin, and they made loads of jokes about that. And it was awful. I was thinking, oh, this is just the worst thing. But do you know what? The strange thing was, over those weeks, number one, it really made me stand up for my faith. I actually had to be a Christian in that space, because I'd become so defined by it. They watched what I did, what I said, how I operated. So I was really aware of how I tried to live out being a Christian in that place, how I responded when they were wolf whistling at people going down the street, how I responded when there was really crude jokes going around. I was really aware in that space, I am literally being a witness for Jesus. So I was really careful over what I did and said. And it was amazing over the weeks, gradually, how I had all these opportunities to share with people about Jesus. And in fact, in the very last week I was working there, the foreman came in again in a bit of a bluster and said, "Right, you, I want to take you out for a drink after work." I was like, oh my goodness, I'm in trouble again. He sat me down in the pub after work and he said, "You know, okay, come on then. See how you've been these last few weeks. Come on then, tell me something about Jesus." And I got to start to speak to him about God. And you know what I heard a few weeks later? He went to a friend of mine's church and became a Christian. I'm not saying it was all because what was going on through me, but I found out later that his wife was a Christian. That's why he'd reacted so strongly against it. You see, amazing things can happen when you make a very small stand. Just like Daniel decided, you know what? I'm not going to eat that food. And it started him off on a journey. Started him off saying, you know what, I'm going to make a stand. I'm not going to be assimilated. I'm not going to allow myself to just do all of the stuff that everybody else does. And so what is it for you this morning? Maybe it's how you speak. Maybe it's about being upfront with people about the fact that you've been to church over the weekend. And that you weren't even dragged, you actually quite enjoyed it. Maybe it's that you're a Christian, you need to tell some people that you're a Christian, they don't know it. Maybe if you're really honest, you get dragged into gossip, even gossip around the church all the time, and you think, you know what, actually that's not really me living out the fullness of what it means to be a follower of Jesus, and I need to change that. So maybe there's something this morning you're thinking, I need to make a stand here, a small stand maybe. Well, I'm going to leave something behind. Or maybe it's the opposite of leaving something behind. And actually, God is calling you to make a small stand by picking something up. Picking up a discipline that's going to help you, a small little thing that's going to help you live out the reality of the identity that God has for you. Can I just remind you, friends, this morning of the woven rule of life? You know, one of the things I've found so helpful since we've talked about this rule of life is the scripture readings. You know, every morning my alarm goes off, my coffee, I grab a cup of coffee, and I just read. It takes about 5 to 10 minutes usually, just read the scripture. I ask God to meet me as I read it. I read it, and then I just explore it with God. I just say, God, is there something in this scripture today that would help me, that would speak to me, that would challenge me? And I just let God highlight a bit of the Bible to me, and then I ask him, okay, God, is this something I should be praying about or doing today because of what I've read today? And then that's it. I just leave it with him. And I found it profound, friends. It's a small change. It's a small change, but it means that every morning as I get up and as I open my Bible, I'm reminded I'm a foreigner in exile. I live in this world. I'm part of this world, but I'm made for a different kingdom. And every morning I'm reminded as I do that. Or maybe this morning you're becoming aware of someone you need to forgive. You need to engage that heart part of the rule of life, or prayer, or coming regularly to church. You know, one of the wonderful things we do here as we gather in church is every Sunday we sing songs, we open the Bible, we meet with other people who are also not from this world, who are made for something else. We're made for God's kingdom. And we need to, just like Daniel, remind ourselves we're not going to be assimilated. So let me just pause for a moment and pray, and I'm going to hand back to the service leader who's going to lead you in a response. Let's pray. Just take a moment with God. God, we just thank you so, so much for Daniel's refusal to be assimilated. Lord, we thank you for his stand. Lord, help each one of us make a stand. Remind us of the reality of our identities. We are children of God. We are made for your kingdom. We are foreigners and exiles. We are longing for you, God. But Lord, I pray that you'd help us just receive your spirit this morning, that would help us discern how it is you are calling us to make a stand. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, we're now going to have an opportunity to respond, and that challenge that we heard of where is God calling us to make a stand. And we're going to respond by sharing communion together this morning. And as Rich shared with us, that challenge of what might be the things where perhaps we've become assimilated to the things of this world that God is calling us to leave behind, to surrender to him. And then what is he calling us to pick up so that we can make that stand for him, so that we can live out more fully our identities as children of God. And as we come to receive communion this morning, I therefore offer you, we have this opportunity that as you come forward and as we receive, there's an opportunity to lay down the things of ourselves in this world, but then to receive from God more fully the gifts of his spirit and our identity as his children. So as we respond this morning, if you feel comfortable and are able, can I invite you to stand as we respond in prayer this morning with communion? And the words of the prayer to join in with will come up on the screen now. The Lord is here. His spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through Christ your Son, our Lord, and grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. Who in the same night that he was betrayed, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And let us declare our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Therefore, Heavenly Father, proclaiming his saving death and resurrection and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect sacrifice. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat this bread and as we drink this cup, renew us by your Spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom we worship you, Father Almighty. And please do sit or kneel as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. As we come to receive communion this morning, there will be two stations here at the front. If you come to my station here at the front, I will have gluten-free wafers and non-alcoholic wine. If you would like gluten-free wafers, please do come up first. So draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts. By faith, with thanksgiving.
Jesus is calling. to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Father God, we thank you for your gift of love and life for us upon the cross. And as we receive from you this morning, Father God, would you be filling us up by your Spirit to send us out, to be your church, to live out our God-given kingdom identities in you, to make a stand for you and to share you with the world around us, we pray. Amen. Well, we're going to respond with one last song of worship. So if you feel comfortable and are able, please do stand. And if you would like prayer ministry for anything, perhaps it's something that you felt challenged by during the talk or something you brought with you this morning, then our prayer ministry team are here on my left, your right. They would love to pray with you. But let's stand and let's worship God in one final song this morning.
To those